God, I know that a lot of us are going through different things right now, and especially, I don't know why, but it seems to be like during the holidays, the time that we should be the most joyful. Sometimes it's not a time of joy when it's a time of great stress. There are things that happen to us, and because of this, we get very worried, we get really stressful. But I want you to know that your time that you spend in the Bible is going to help to relieve you of all of these stress. That doesn't mean that your stress are going to go away, but there's something very powerful that happens when we hand over our stress to God and say, hey God, your words tell me to turn these things to you. And so we need to continually be in the Word. Today's message, today's sermon, I want this to be able to impact your head. Hopefully you'll know more about the Bible after this. But I don't want you to just walk away having more head knowledge. I want the sermon today to impact your heart. And when you allow God's Word to impact your heart, it flows down into your hands. Your lives are transformed by this. We must be doers of God's Word, just not hearers of the Word. And so let us be changed because of His Word. And so we need to apply God's Word. In Proverbs chapter 23, verse 12, it says, apply your heart to instruction and your ears to the word of knowledge. And so we must be willing to apply God's Word. Because if we don't, there's going to be no change that's going to happen. And I don't know about you guys, but I need more positive change to happen in my life. And that's going to first start off with us applying the Word of God. This is today's comic. Mother and baby are doing well. Both are in a stable condition. Get it? Okay. Baby Jesus was born in a stable. They're both in a stable condition. Okay. All right. So anyways, this entire month, we are doing the Songs of Christmas sermon series. Last week, we did Silent Night. And so I think you guys are pretty aware which one we're going to be doing today. And so today's sermon title, it is going to be titled, Oh, What a Night. And so the sermon question is this. What was so great about the night when Jesus was born? And so what is so important about Jesus' birth on that night? We're going to study this question. And so maybe perhaps you yourself have also asked, what is the true significance of the birth of Jesus Christ on that night? And it's really simple. Because the night of our Savior's birth brought us back to a restored relationship with God. If there's one thing that you can walk away and remember today, it's really simple. This is all that I want you to remember. Because Jesus Christ was born on that night, our relationship with God was restored again through this one event, the birth of Christ. So, to get us started, I wanted to ask you guys this question. So growing up, what did you remember about the night of Christmas Eve? What do you guys got? As a child, what are your memories growing up remembering about Christmas Eve? What's nostalgic to you? Joan?
One of the things that we are presented to me that was made by my great-great-great-great-great-uncle 1931 back over in Germany, Austria.
Okay. Okay.
And the neighbor was always empty.
Okay.
And so Christmas Eve.
Sure. Okay. So that was a big part of your Christmas Eve with your family. Anybody else? Okay. All right.
We were at home with my brother.
Okay. So at your family, Christmas Eve, everybody gets to open up one present? Okay. Awesome. Okay. Now at my house, if we did that, I wouldn't have any more presents for Christmas. Okay? Anybody else? What are your memories about Christmas Eve? Okay, Deb?
Depending on the year, but the good year is it was getting all dressed up and going to church.
Okay, getting all dressed up and going to church. Okay, all right. All right, Harley?
Spending time with family.
Spending time with your family? Luke?
I remember one year waking up and I caught my dad bringing in a bike.
Okay. All right.
And the next morning, it said from Santa.
Okay.
That's my new Santa, not real. Rush. So, then he tried to tell me that Santa was just in a rush.
Yeah.
Santa handed it to me and I brought it in and then he was gone and I'm the next house.
The lesson learned is you better not epically fail like your father, right?
You better not wake up. You better not wake up in one of the morning.
Yeah.
You're gonna see
too. All right. So today's sermon, we're gonna focus on this song, O Holy Night. Okay. And so, if you don't know, these are the two individuals that have contributed to how this song came. So Mr. Capo and Mr. Adam. So Classic Capo, he was the guy that actually wrote the lyrics to this song. And just like last week, he got the lyrics all good, but then he couldn't figure out the, the melody. So he didn't know the melody to it. And so then Adult Adam ended up becoming the composer to put the lyrics and the melody together. And so this is the story of how O Holy Night, this famous song, became written. Yeah.
A strange and fascinating story of O Holy Night began in France. In 1847, Placide Capot was a poet in a small French town. As a non-religious man, he was probably shocked when his parish priest asked him to pen a poem for Christmas Mass. In a dusty coach traveling down a bumpy road to France's capital city, Placide Capot considered the priest's request. Using the Gospel of Luke as his guide, he imagined witnessing the birth of Jesus in Bethlehem. Thoughts of being present on that blessed night inspired him, and by the time he arrived in Paris, Cantique de Noël had been completed. Moved by his own work, he decided this was not just a poem, but a song in need of a master musician's hand. Not musically inclined himself, the poet turned to one of his friends, Adolphe Adam, for help. As a man of Jewish ancestry, for Adolphe, the words of Cantique de Noël represented a day he didn't celebrate, and a man he did not view as the Son of God. Nevertheless, Adam quickly went to work, adding a beautiful original score to Capot's powerful words. Adam finished work, pleased both poet and priest. The song was performed just 3 weeks later at a midnight mass on Christmas Eve. Initially, Cantique de Noël was wholeheartedly accepted by the church in France, and the song quickly found its way into various Christmas services. But when Capot walked away from the faith and became a part of the socialist movement, and church leaders discovered that Adam was a Jew, the song, which had quickly grown to be one of the most beloved Christmas songs in France, was suddenly and uniformly banned by the church. However, a decade later, a reclusive American writer brought it to a whole new audience halfway around Europe. John Sullivan Dwight not only felt that America needed to hear this carol, there was something else in the song that moved him beyond the story of the birth of Christ. As an ardent abolitionist, Dwight strongly identified with the lines of the third verse, "Chains shall we break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease." The text supported Dwight's own view of slavery in the South. His English translation of O Holy Night quickly found favor in America, especially in the North during the Civil War. Back in France, legend has it that on Christmas Eve 1871, in the midst of fierce fighting during the Franco-Prussian War, a French soldier suddenly jumped out of his mother trench. Both sides stared at the seemingly crazed man. Boldly standing with no weapon in his hand or at his side, he lifted his eyes to the heavens and sang the opening lines of Cantique de Noël. After completing all three verses, a German infantryman climbed out of his hiding place and answered with a few robust verses of a sacred German carol. The story goes that the fighting stopped for the next 24 hours while the men on both sides observed a temporary peace in honor of Christmas Day. The song's legacy continued on Christmas Eve 1906 as Reginald Fezzendine, a 33-year-old university professor, did something long thought impossible. Using a new type of generator, Fezzendine spoke into a microphone, and for the first time in history, a man's voice was broadcast over the airwaves. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed, he began in a clear, strong voice. Shocked radio operators on ships and astonished wireless owners at newspapers sat slack-jawed as their normal coded impulses were replaced by a professor reading from the Gospel of Luke. It must have seemed like a miracle, hearing a voice somehow transmitted to those far away. Some might have believed they were hearing the voice of an angel. After finishing his recitation of the birth of Christ, Fezzendine picked up his violin and played "Oh Holy Night," the first song ever sent through the air via radio waves. When the carol ended, so did the broadcast, but not before music had found a new medium that would take it around the world. Since that first rendition of the small Christmas Mass of 1847, "Oh Holy Night" has been sung millions of times in churches in every corner of the world. And since the moment a handful of people first heard it played over the radio, the carol has gone on to become one of the most recorded and played spiritual songs. This incredible work, requested by a forgotten parish priest, written by a poet who would later split from the church, given soaring music by a Jewish composer, and brought to the Americans to serve as much as a tool to spotlight the sinful nature of slavery as to tell the story of the birth of the Savior, yes, it has become one of the most beautiful, inspired pieces of music ever created.
So these are the entire lyrics to "O Holy Night." It's kind of interesting right over here. "Chains shall he break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease." So you can imagine the abolitionists, how they can really relate to how it is that, all men should be free. Spiritually thinking about that, a lot of us were enslaved to sin, and how we need God to just come and free us from that. And so as you guys can tell, there's lots of lyrics to "O Holy Night," but today we're going to focus on just really kind of like that first part. Okay, so "O Holy Night," and so we're going to take a look at where it says "O Holy Night." And so, holy. So, if we don't know what the word holy means, then we kind of miss this entire song, because, the song itself, "O Holy Night." And so what does the word holy mean? So the biblical use of the term holy has to do primarily with God separating himself from the world. God is so pure, God is so perfect, and because of this, he is righteous, that he must be set apart from us sinners. God is perfect holiness. You see, God is so perfect that he cannot stand to be in the sight of sin. And that's what we are. We're all sinners. And so because God is so righteous, God is so holy, he has to separate himself from us because we are not righteous. We are not perfect. We are not holy. It's kind of like this. If somebody has the Ebola virus, what do we need to do with them? They need to be quarantined. They need to be separated so that the rest of us cannot be contaminated. You see, that person that's in there, that's us. Because we're full of sin. We're sinners. And those people are like, God, they need to be separated from us. God is so perfect and so holy that he needs to be separated from us because we are full of sin. So this is us. We as people, we are sinful. No one of us is going to be perfect in this lifetime. And that's the reason why we need God so much. So today's Bible verse, Romans chapter 3, verse 10 to 18, As the scriptures say, no one is righteous, not even one. You may think that you got your act together. You may think that you're perfect. You may think that you're holy. But the Bible reminds all of us that there are things in your life that makes you not perfect. No one is righteous, not even one. The only perfect person that has ever lived is Jesus Christ himself. No one is truly wise. No one is seeking God. All have turned away. There have been times in your life and my life where we have turned our back against God. And this is the reason why we're not perfect. Because there are times in our life when we have betrayed God for other things. All have become useless. No one does good, not a single one. So as I look out on the audience, I see a bunch of people who are imperfect. But the really cool thing is, just like our slogan, if you're not perfect, you've come to the right place. We're all a bunch of mess-ups. We all need God. This is the reason why. Somebody told me before, church should not be a museum for the saints, but a hospital for the sick. This is the reason why we're here, is because we acknowledge that I'm not perfect, but I know who is perfect, which is God, and I need God in my life. Their talk is foul like the stench from an open grave. Their tongues are filled with lies. Snake venom drips from their lips. Their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. They rush to commit murder. Destruction and misery always follow them. They don't know where to find peace. They have no fear of God at all. This describes your heart and my heart. We might not have all of these, but you know what? You don't need to have all of this. All it takes is for you to have one of this for us to contaminate our pure heart that God has given us. So don't think that you're a little bit more better off because you ain't like that person who's got all these sinful things. No, sin is sin. And so this is the world. The world is full of sin. But then it says the stars are brightly shining. So this is the world. The world is full of sin. And because the world is full of sin, there is darkness in the world. Nobody ever commits sin, and after that, they feel so happy. They see light. There's joy in their heart. All of us, when we have God in our life, and that's not to say we're going to be perfect, but when we have God in our heart and we fall down, we sin, you can feel that darkness just around you to say, man, I feel so bad. I feel so dark for what I have done. That's sin. And when there's sin in the world, there's darkness. But the really amazing thing about that night when Jesus Christ was born is that the stars were shining brightly for that evening. And the reason why is because the light of God came, and that was the light of Jesus Christ to illuminate the world, not with darkness, but to be able to shine brightly for all of us to see. And then it says, it is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Okay? So Jesus Christ, that was his birthday. So just so that you guys do know, December 25th is not actually Jesus Christ's birthday. It's just a symbolism for us to dedicate one day to say this is the one day that we're going to celebrate his birthday. We can't pinpoint exactly what day it was. And the reason why is because when Jesus Christ was born, there wasn't like a hospital that Jesus went to and say, Jesus Christ has arrived. It's on this day, at this time, at this many inches, at this many pounds, right? That didn't happen. So we don't know the exact day that he was born. And to me, I don't really care when Jesus was exactly born. To me, I think it's important that at a bare minimum, we acknowledge one day, I mean, I think that should be more than one day, but we acknowledge one day in which we celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. So then it says, long lay the world in sin. So there was a time where the world was perfect. There was no sin. And then sin was introduced into the world by Adam and Eve. You see, God gave them the choice. You can either follow me or you can disobey me. And so they decided that they were going to be disobedient by disobeying God, by eating from the fruit from the tree of good and evil. And so when they disobeyed God, that's when sin entered the world. And so then you and I, we are the great, 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 great grandkids of Adam and Eve. We can trace our genealogy all the way back to Adam and Eve. And so because they sinned, you and I, we are born with this original sin. If you have kids, you guys can see that, you know what? You didn't even tell your kids when they were born, oh, like, you should become disobedient. You should cry whenever you want. You should not listen to mom and dad. But you know what? These kids that are born, they do that, okay? As much as we love them, they're already born with some of this sin. And so that makes all of us not perfect, okay? So now we are no longer living in a perfect world, but instead we live in a very broken world. The Bible tells us that these are the seven deadly sins. And so I don't care who you are, but every single one of us, we at least struggle with one of these sins. And some of us can humbly admit, Pastor Yao, that's my life. I struggle with maybe seven of these sins all the time. Anger, lust, envy, sloth, gluttony, greed, pride. These are the seven deadly sins that's in our life. And if we're not careful, then what's going to happen is that these sins control our life. And so when you look at the world, today when I look at the world, I see more brokenness than I do. For some of you that have a few more years on me, you guys can definitely attest to how America used to be, how families used to be intact, how the churches used to be intact. And today in America, in 2018, how broken our society, our churches, our families have become. And the reason why is because we are allowing sin to continue to grow and fester in this world. And so we live in a sick world of sin. If you want to know how sick it is, all you have to do is turn on the news. If you want to know how sick the world is, you just have to read the newspaper. If you want to see how sick the world is, you just got to go on Facebook, and you will be reminded what the world has come to. We are not living in pretty times today. I believe that the nation has become worse today than it was when some of us were growing up. And so the Bible reminds us of how bad this is. Galatians chapter 5, verse 19 and 21 says, when you follow the desires of your sinful nature. So that's in us, okay? So we have that in us, the sinful nature. The results are very clear. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and other sins like these. Let me tell you again, as I have before, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. When I look at that list, that's a long list. And I don't know about you guys, but I could about check every single one of these on this list. So this is what I used to do. These were the sins that I used to struggle with. But today, I'm in a better place because I realize that I cannot defeat these sins by myself. I need to turn my life over to my God. And when that happens, God starts to give me the victory in my life to conquer these sins. Because if we're not careful, that last sentence is very, very revealing. Let me tell you again, as I have before, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. If you continue to allow these sins to be a part of your life, and you are not ready to cut that cancer from your life, God is telling us these things are going to pull you away from the kingdom of God. Some of you guys might be saying, but I don't do all of these things. It doesn't matter. All it takes is for you to hang on to one of these sins, for you to then one day be pulled away from the kingdom of heaven. Let us not be deceived to think that I don't got all these problems. I only have one little struggle. That's all that it takes. All it takes is for one little cancer cell to kill the entire body if we're not going to cut that right away. Okay? So this next part, airplaning. So I listen to 89Q all the time, and most of these lyrics, I understand. But when it comes to All Holy Night, and when I hear airplaning, it's like, what in the world does that mean? Do you guys look at each other like, what did that just mean? What did I just say? Okay? Airplaning. Now, we kind of know that first part, but that second word, besides O Holy Night, in any other circumstances, I had never heard anyone else using the word pining. Maybe I'm just not educated enough or whatever, okay? But I struggle to like understand that, okay? So if this is you today, we're going to clear that up so we actually know what the word air pining means, because what in the world, okay? Air. We all know what error is, right? Okay, so it's a mess up, it's a screw up, right? All right, so we know that one. But this next part, this pining word, what does that mean, okay? So I had to do some research. The word pining is suffer with longing, to waste away. All right, so that's what it means, to have this long suffering, to kind of waste away. So let me give you a Yao example, okay? This example makes sense to me, okay? And that might make sense to some of us hunters. For example, I was pining for the 30-point buck I shot that I could not find. Okay? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Like you're suffering with longing because you shot this thing and you couldn't find it. It's like eating away at you because I should have killed it. I should have gotten that 30-point buck, but I can't find it. Okay? So pining, to suffer, like, oh my God, why is this so happening? To waste away. So then, when you put air pining away, it's basically this. It means the world lay wasting away due to all of its sin. Air pining. The world lay wasting away due to all of its sins. So basically, before Jesus Christ came here to earth, the world just lay suffering in all the sins of this world. and all of its errors of the world. That's what it meant. The world was suffering in complete sin, just being wasted away.
Find a child wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.
Here we were, people with all this great sin, separated from God. And so God is holy. God cannot stand to be in the sight of our sins. That's the reason why there is this great separation or divide. But thank goodness that God loved us so much that God sent Jesus Christ to come so that 33 years later, he would eventually be killed on the cross for all of our sins. So then it says, a thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices. And so Jesus Christ, his birth represents hope to all of us. In Romans chapter 8, verse 19 to 24, okay? For all creation is waiting eagerly for the future day when God will reveal who his children really are. Against its will, all creation was subjected to God's curse, but with eager hope. Okay? So with eager hope, this is us waiting, okay, for Jesus. The creation looks forward to the day when it will join God's children in glorious freedom from death and decay. For we know that all creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. And we believers also groan, even though we have the Holy Spirit within us as a foretaste of future glory. For we long for our bodies to be released from sin and suffering. We too wait with eager hope. So the world was eagerly waiting for this hope of Jesus Christ. For the new day when God will give us our full rights as his adopted children, including the new bodies he has promised us. We were given this hope, which is found in Jesus Christ. When we were saved, if we already have something, we don't need to hope for it. So if you think about it, the birth of Jesus Christ, it all gives us the hope that, you know what, I don't deserve God's love, but God is sending Jesus Christ to me. And so that's the hope that I wait upon, that God is going to be there for me. And so Jesus Christ, this is really the birth of hope. Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ was born, because he lived, because he died on the cross for our sins, Jesus Christ is the one to come and break our chains of sin. He is the one that is going to release us from our bondage of enslavery to Satan. And then it says, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. So yonder basically means somewhere at a distance breaks a new and glorious morn. So the next day after Jesus was born, the world sees the Savior of the world in flesh for the first time. And so in the distance, we see the birth of Jesus Christ. We see what God's love for us is like, and that is found in the little child being born. And so for the first time, they see the Messiah, Jesus Christ. And that's the reason why in Romans chapter 13, 11 to 14, I'll just highlight here, it says, wake up, for our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is almost gone. And so the night of suffering, all this time of us living our life in sin, having no hope, Jesus Christ is about to be revealed to the world. The morning sun is going to come, and that is going to show Jesus Christ to us. It's really awesome. So Jesus Christ, he was content being born, okay, being in a stable. So Christ was content with a stable when he was born, so that we can die and have a mansion when our time is up. Because he was willing to do that, be born in a stable. So that later on, when you and I, when it's time for us to go, we're going to go and live in this huge mansion. Okay? All right. So I want to inspire you guys with this cute story about kind of how innocent children are and how funny they can be. So the story goes that there was a child. And so there was this girl, and she was 10 years old. And so one day her family decided that in their community, they're going to go and see all the different light displays during Christmas. Because during that time, the entire communities lit up with all these different light shows throughout the entire neighborhood. So then they go all these different places, and then they finally get to a church. And so this family stopped at the church, and at the church, you know how a lot of churches have a nativity scene someday when we get our own place? We'll also have a nativity scene, okay? So this girl goes there with her family. They're looking at this nativity scene. And so this grandma says to the 10-year-old girl, "Hey, look at that nativity scene. Isn't that so beautiful?" The grandma says. So then the grandma says, "Look, you can see the angels. You can see Joseph. You can see Mary. And you can see baby Jesus." And so with that, the little daughter says, "Yes, Grandma, I see all of that. It's really nice. But there's one thing that just really bothers me. Isn't baby Jesus ever going to grow up? He's the same size as he was last year still." Every time they say baby, baby Jesus, he's still just a little baby. And sometimes it's hard for these kids to comprehend that. Because every year during Christmas, Jesus is a baby again. Doesn't baby Jesus ever grow up? He does. Okay? They just don't know. Okay. So let's do something with this message about the birth of Jesus Christ. Okay? So it says, in the chaos of your busy holiday, all of you guys are busy, crazy with everything. Have you given thanks to God for how much he loves you by the birth of Jesus Christ on that holy night? Have you really just maybe sat back recently and just been like, "God, thank you for what you did on that holy night"? Yeah, thank you. I want you guys to go into 1 minute prayer about that. This is the reason why today's sermon question was, what was so great about the night when Jesus Christ was born? It's so awesome because the night of our Savior's birth brought us back to a restored relationship with God. Here we were, here was God, it was a broken relationship. Christ came in the middle because he was born, and he says, "I will be the one to connect the broken world to God's holiness." And so that happened through his birth. And that's the reason why it's so awesome. And that's the reason why today's sermon title is, "Oh, what a night. What a perfect night that was." Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, thank you so much for loving us. And Lord God, thank you for just loving us so much, Lord. As broken and as sinful as we were, Lord, you restored us back to you by sending Jesus Christ to be born over 2,000 years ago for us. And Lord God, that's the greatest gift that we can ever receive. It is the birth of Jesus Christ. And Lord God, thank you for packaging in that, that in such a small way. But Lord God, that package is so big in so many other ways. And so Lord God, today we just come and we thank you for just sending Jesus Christ to be born for all of us. Because of him, Lord God, we have life. Lord God, we're connected to you. We are restored to you because of this birth. We thank you so much. We love you. We pray all these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen. And so at this time, we're going to end it with "Oh, Holy Night," led by our worship team.
Night, the stars are brightly shining.